יעקב בארץ מצרים 17 שנה, ויהי ימי יעקב שני חייו 7 שנים ו-40 ומאת שנה. בעזרת השם, פרשת ויהי. Liz, please, will you read for us in English?
Jacob lived in the land of Egypt 17 years, and the days of Jacob, the years of his life, were 147 years.
Okay, the Torah tells us that Yaakov Avinu lived in Egypt 17 years. We have to understand why the Torah have to tell us that Yaakov lived 17 years. What's hiding behind it? Why Dafka in Egypt? What's the story behind all of this? We'll try to understand. Vayehi, our sages tell us, and the Mefarshim also explain that Vayehi referring to life. That means that after Yaakov Avinu lived for so many years, Yaakov Avinu was, just for the record, Yaakov was 130 when he arrived in Egypt. Because Yaakov Avinu died in an age of 147. Yeah. Less 17 years that he lived in Egypt, 130. Yaakov Avinu arrived in Egypt in the age of 130. Yaakov Avinu didn't have an easy life. All of his life was difficulty. From the moment that he was in a mother's womb, was Esav. Didn't finish with Esav, came Lavan. Didn't finish with Lavan, have the problem that with Dinah. Not with Dinah, Rachel died. Not only that, his beloved son, Yosef, been disappeared for 22 years. So now, after 130 years, Yaakov Avinu come to teach us something very important. That even that he was 130 years old, after 22 years of hard separation from his beloved son that he didn't see for 22 years, what the other person will do? He said, that's it. I'm old enough. I want to retire. I want peace. I want to spend my time with my beloved son for the rest of my life, for whatever years I have. Yaakov come to tell us, Vayehi Yaakov. What it mean? The Torah tell us, Vayehi Yaakov. That the only way that Yaakov can live in Egypt, by studying Torah. To come to teach us. And the same like the Gemara in Masechet Brachot tell us in page 18, folio 2. The Gemara tell us there, Tzadikim consider as a living person. And a wicked person considered as a dead person while they are alive. Why? Because they don't study Torah. So here come to teach us the Torah, that Yaakov Avinu come to teach us something very important. What is the important? Studying Torah. That's what gives life to a human being. Let's continue on.
Also the gematria of Vayechi.
Sure, we're going to get to it now. I didn't forget. Rashi HaKadosh say, Parasha Zos Stuma. That this parsha is a blocked parsha. Let me explain what the difference between parasha ptuha and parasha stuma. Usually in a Sefer Torah, between every parsha, we have a space. The space is nine small letters between parsha, at least, minimum. So in this parsha, on parashat Vayehi, and the previous parasha, parashat Vayigash, there is no space. Immediately it's moved on. There is no space in the Sefer Torah. So Rashi HaKadosh say, Parasha Stuma. And Rashi continue and explain, you know why is that Parasha considered as a blocked Parasha? So Rashi HaKadosh say, because when Yaakov Avinu passed away, when he died, when Yaakov Avinu passed away, the eyes of the Jewish people got blocked and the heart. What does it mean? We have to understand why is the Parasha blocked. But as Les asked before, what does it mean, Vayehi, the Gematria? Gematria of Vayehi is 34, Vav 6, Yud 10, together 16, plus 8 of Het, that gives us 24, plus Yud gives us 34. The Mefarshim explain, Rabbi Yaakov Baal HaTurim, he's the one that bringing it. Rabbi Yaakov Baal HaTurim, born in Germany 748 years ago. And he says, Vayehi Gematria 34, to teach us something very important. That the first 17 years of Yosef HaTzadik that he was, from the day that he born until the age of 17, that was the beautiful time for Yaakov Avinu that they spent together. The other 17 years was when Yaakov Avinu came down to Egypt while Yosef was the vice to Pharaoh. So to tell us, Vayechi, that Yaakov lived the best life of his life during the first 17 years of the life of Yosef that spent with him from the day that he born until he disappeared. And the rest of the 17 years, when Yaakov came down to Egypt and lived in Egypt, while his son Yosef was the ruler. So from here we see two commentaries about Vayechi. But let's go back to what we say about Parashah Stuma. Why is the Parashah Stuma? So most of the commentaries tell us that the Parashah Stuma, why is it? So Rashi say that when Yosef, when Yaakov Avinu died, the eyes of Bnei Israel got blocked. Not only that got blocked, also their heart. And then he say, and that's when the enslavery started. The Sha'bud start. What it mean, the Sha'bud? But the Mefarshim say something very extraordinary. The Mefarshim say, as a matter of fact, to say that they ask, how can it be? We know that until the final member of the tribe was, until he died, was no slavery. Just for their general knowledge, the first one to die from all the tribe was Yosef HaTzadik in the age of 110. The last one to die from the tribe was Levi. And the Midrash tells us that Hazal said that none of the slavery started until the final member of the tribe passed away. So how can you say, Rashi, that now after the pass away of Yaakov Avinu, the slavery started? So I'm going to bring two different commentary. The first one is from Sfat Emet. Sfat Emet is a book that been written by Rabbi Aryeh Lev. He born in Poland 170 years ago. And he said something extraordinary. He said that true that the physical slavery never started, but the spiritual enslavery already started. What does it mean? That while Yaakov Avinu was in Egypt, Bnei Israel never have any doubt. Bnei Israel felt the holiness, saw the miracle in the front of their eyes. For example, when Yaakov Avinu came to Egypt, it was the beginning of the famine, the first 2 years of the famine. When Yaakov Avinu arrived in Egypt, the famine stopped for 17 years until he passed away. So Bnei Israel saw all of that. They never have any doubt. They saw the Kedusha, the holiness that Yaakov was bringing. And they never have any doubt. Once that Yaakov Avinu passed away, they lost all the spirituality that was on that level. Not only that, they have a lot of doubt. And all the miracles disappear. So that's when the spiritual enslavement started. Although, the other commentaries bring different commentary. And they say like this. And they say that as long that Yaakov Avinu was alive, the enslavement didn't start, they're speaking about the spiritual. But now that he died, and Yosef HaTzadik and Bnei Israel have to ask permission from Pharaoh to go to bury their father in Eretz Israel, and that depends on the permission of Pharaoh, that's considered slavery. Nachon, that it's not a physical slavery, but once that the person have to ask other people for permission, that's considered like he's in slavery. And Bnei Israel here, we see that there was in slavery. Not only that, we know that Pharaoh didn't want to allow Yosef HaTzadik to go down to Egypt because he was worried who going to run his country. But Yosef HaTzadik took an oath and he said to Pharaoh, I took an oath to my dad. So Pharaoh said to him, do announcement of the vow. He said, in that case, I'm going to do other announcement of the vow. I know 71 languages when you know only 70. So you have two options. Or allowing me to go to Eretz Israel to bury my father, or I tell that I know more languages than you, and then I'm going to be the king. Pharaoh realized that, and he allowed Yosef HaTzadik to go and bury his father in Eretz Israel. So from here we see...
Why would he be the king if He knew one more language.
Because he knew one more language. And Hazal asked, which language he knew? Sfat HaKodesh. Hebrew.
And Pharaoh didn't know.
Hebrew. So he knew extra language. And the constitution in Egypt say that if you know 71 languages, and the other one knows 70 or 69, whoever knows more languages, he can be the king. So that's what Pharaoh was worried. Very good question. Let's move to chapter 47, verse 29. And here we see something very interesting. Vayikrevu yemei Yisrael lamut, vayikra lebno leYosef, vayomer lo, imna matzahti hen be'enecha, simna yadcha tahat yerechi, va'asita imadi chesed ve'emet, al na tikbereni be'mitzrayim. Will you read for us in English?
Yeah. Jacob lived in the land of Egypt 17 years, and the days of Jacob, the years of his life, were 147 years. Time approached for Israel to die, so he called his son for Joseph and said to him, please, if I have favor in your eyes, place your hand under my thigh and do kindness and truth with me. Please do not bury me in Egypt, for I will not.
Yeah. So here we see that Yaakov Avinu actually begged Yosef HaTzadik, his son, to be buried in Eretz Israel and not to be buried in the land of Egypt. When we say the land of Egypt, we are referring to Eretz Goshen because that's where the Jewish people lived. The question that most of the Mefarshim raise, why it was so important that Yaakov Avinu have to beg his son not to bury him in the land of Egypt? So on the pshat of the Dvarim, Yaakov Avinu wanted to be buried with his father and with his grandfather. But the Kabbalistic rabbi explained something extraordinary. They explained that Yaakov Avinu was the fourth leg of the Merkava. What it means, the fourth leg? The fourth leg of the chariot. Lehavdil, lehavdil, that's where HaKadosh Baruch Hu sit. It's not for us to understand, but it's in a different level. It's to teach us that Yaakov Avinu was the fourth leg for the glory, the chair of glory of HaKadosh Baruch Hu. How can it be? Because it was Adam v'Hava being buried in Ma'arat HaMachpelah, and then Abraham and Sarah, Yitzhak v'Rivka, and Yaakov and Leah. They, all of those four couples buried in Ma'arat HaMachpelah, and there was all a leg to the chair of HaKadosh Baruch Hu. And Yaakov Avinu knew that, that if he's not going to bury it in Ma'arat HaMachpelah, he can't have, and he can't be the fourth legs. Therefore, Yaakov Avinu said the Mefarshim that it's very important for Yaakov was that he will bury in Ma'arat HaMachpelah. But Rashi HaKadosh continue and bring three different explanations. The one is that Yaakov Avinu didn't want to be buried in Egypt because he knew that in Egypt will be lice, the lice of the plague, and he was worried that the lice will eat his flesh after he passed away. The second idea, that Yaakov Avinu was worried that they're not going to turn him to idols and they start worshiping him. Shelo yasu menu avodah zarah. The third idea that that Rashi bring is rolling of the tunnel. What it mean, rolling of the tunnel? We have a concept in Jewish law that called Gilgul Mehilot. What it mean, Gilgul Mehilot? That when the Mashiach come, please God, speedily in our days, the Mashiach, when he come, all the dead bodies will come out of the grave and will stood up, and then he will throw Maim Haim, that means living water, and they will come alive. But those that have been buried in a diaspora, they have to roll through a tunnels until they arrive in Israel. And that's a bit of a suffering, Hazal say. That's what the Hazal explained to us in Gemara Masechet Ketubot, page 111, folio 2. There Hazal explained about the rolling of the tunnel. Although Hazal there bring another opinion that the tzaddikim will have a tunnel and is such a height that they can walk and they don't have to roll through the tunnel. So they're not going to suffer. But let's go back to what Rashi say. Rashi say Number one, that Yaakov Avinu was worried that the lion's not going to eat his flesh. And number two, not going to turn him to Avodah Zarah. But the Mefarshim ask, wait, I don't understand. We know that during the 10 plagues, it was all the plagues that we mentioned. But one, none of the plague arrived in Eretz Goshen. So what Yaakov Avinu was worried? Yaakov Avinu going to be buried where? In Eretz Goshen. What is he worried? And there was no life. So if there is no life, what is he worried? So the Mefarshim ask, what's the connection between Avodah Zarah to life? So the answer is, the Mefarshim explained that Yaakov Avinu was worried from number one, Avodah Zarah and life, and the connection is like this. Yaakov Avinu said that if he's going to be buried in Eretz Mitzrayim, in the land of Canaan, in the land of Goshen, none of the life is going to be there. And the Egyptian going to see that, and they're going to start thinking, hey, what's happening here? Why life never happened in the land of Goshen? What they're going to say? Because Yaakov Avinu was the righteous man, and he was so holy, and his merit, none of the 10 plagues will be allowed to come to Eretz Goshen. And after his death, they're going to start worshiping him, turning him to God, and start worshiping him. So Yaakov Avinu was worried of that. And by the way, the Rambam, Rabbi Moshe ben Maimon, he born 882 years ago in a city of Cordova in Spain. And he wrote the Sefer Mishneh Torah. And on his Halachot, Avodah Zarah, he explained that the same like a person not allowed to worship Avodah Zarah, a person not allowed also to turn himself to idols, that other people will worship him. That means Yaakov Avinu was worried, number one, that the Egyptian will turn him to Avodah Zarah and start worshiping him. And that's the connection between Avodah Zarah and life. Let's move on to chapter 48, verse 1. And here we see something very interesting. ויהי אחר הדברים האלה, 48:1, ויהי אחר הדברים האלה, ויאמר ליוסף, הנה אביך חולה, ויקח את שני בניו עמו, את מנשה ואת אפרים.
And it came to pass after these things that someone said to Joseph, behold, your father is ill. So he took his two sons, Manasseh and Ephraim, with him.
Yeah. So here we see something very important. Why, we have to understand the first question, why does the Torah tell us that Yaakov was sick? By the way, for general knowledge, that's the first time that the word chole mentioned in the Torah. Until here, we never heard anywhere that the person was sick. Here the Torah tells us specifically that Yaakov Avinu was sick. What does it mean? Hazal explained in the Gemara Masechet Baba Metzia, chapter 87, folio 1. And she explained like this, that Yaakov Avinu, until Yaakov Avinu, was no sickness in the world. A person was healthy, strong. He was walking on the market or he was at a job. He sneezed and he fell down and he passed away. That's how people used to pass away in the olden days. Until Yaakov Avinu came, and he asked HaKadosh Baruch Hu that the person should get sick, and then he will die. And Hazal explained the reason behind it, that when a person falls sick, he will realize that he has to do atonement, to do tshuva, and then he'll do tshuva, and then HaKadosh Baruch Hu will accept his tshuva, and he have a place, Be'olam Haba, a place in the world to come. So that's why Yaakov Avinu asked for sickness to come to the world. Until Yaakov Avinu was no sickness in the world. HaKadosh Baruch Hu said to Yaakov Avinu, I agree with you. You're the first one to ask, and you're the first one that I'm going to start, and I will bring sickness to the world. And Hazal tell us that that kind of a sickness was until the king Hezekiah. Until the king of Hezekiah, people used to get sick and used to die. Until Hezekiah HaMelech got sick, and he asked HaKadosh Baruch Hu to cure him, and HaKadosh Baruch Hu listened to his prayer, and he did cure him. And Hezekiah HaMelech said to HaKadosh Baruch Hu, if you're going to cure sick people, that's how your name is going to be praised. By that people will see that they daven to you and you listen to them, and you accept their davening, and you forgive to their sin, and they become healthy again. That's how people gonna praise your name, and your name gonna be all over the world to understand that HaKadosh Baruch Hu can do miracles. So we see from here that the Torah come and tell us that Yaakov Avinu was sick. Why it was so important? To teach us that was no sickness until Yaakov Avinu. The sickness started from Yaakov Avinu until Hezekiah HaMelech. And Hezekiah HaMelech asked HaKadosh Baruch Hu that if people will daven and beg for the sick person, he will get cured. So from here we see that the Torah come to teach us something important. The power of davening, the power of the prayer. That there is, that the person can change any decree. Let's move to verse 15.
Why does it say that someone said to Joseph?
Who's that someone? Okay, so the Mefarshim asked about it. We explained it in previous year. Who was that someone to come to tell?
And
to tell who was that sick? So who was all the time with Yaakov Avinu, Hazal asked. Hazal say Ephraim. Ephraim was the son of Yosef. And he was studying with him. As I explained earlier, yesterday also, that Ephraim was the one that was studying Torah with Yaakov Avinu. And Menashe was the one that helped Yosef HaTzadik, where? And running the empire of Egypt. So that someone, Hazal say, who is it? Ephraim. Now the question is, very good question you ask. The Mefarsh, the Hazal say in the Torah, that the person not allowed to say a bad news. So how come that they say bad news here? They didn't mention his name. Because a person not allowed to say Has v'shalom that someone passed away. So how did you say? So Hazal say in the Gemara, in Basechet Baba Metzia, that the person should ask a question, and from that the other person will understand. So here it was the first time in a history that person got sick, and until then no one got sick. So that's why Ephraim can say that Yaakov Avinu was sick, and it don't mention his name. You follow? In verse 15 it says something very interesting. In verse 15 it says like this: המלאך הגואל אותי מכל רע, יברך את הנערים, ויקרא בהם שמי ושם אבותיי, אברהם ויצחק, וידגו לרוב בקרב הארץ. Sorry, I read the wrong verse. Sorry, I meant 15 and I wrote 16. ויברך את יוסף, ויאמר האלוהים אשר התהלכו אבותיי לפניו, אברהם ויצחק, האלוהים הרואה אותי מעודי עד היום הזה. 15.
He blessed Joseph and he said, O God, before whom my forefathers Abraham and Isaac walked, God who shepherds me from my inception until this day.
Here we see something very important. Here we see that the Torah tells us, Vayevarech et Yosef. The Mefarshim asks, especially the Zohar, if you look carefully, he didn't. He blessed Menashe and Ephraim. Or Ephraim and Menashe. He didn't bless Yosef. So how can the Torah say that Yaakov Avinu blessed Yosef HaTzadik? That's the Zohar HaKadosh question. So Rabbi Yossi in the Zohar explained, you know why does it say that Yaakov Avinu blessed Yosef? But when a person bless your kids, there is no bigger blessing to the father like his son getting blessed. So it says, by that Yaakov Avinu blessed Ephraim and Menashe, that was a blessing to Yosef, HaTzadik. Ado, the Rambam, the Maimonite, and Hashalah HaKadosh, both of them say that, something extraordinary, that there is nothing better, there is no better brocha to the father that when you bless his son, and the blessing that you ask, that his son should be talented, should be Talmid Chacham, should be a righteous man, should be a good person. By that you bless the father, the kids, on those blessings, and those children become talented, become righteous, become holy, become good people, good human being, there is no better blessing to the father. So the best blessing that every father wants for his kids to be talented, to follow the footsteps of the father, to be a good man, to be a righteous man, to be a holy man. So therefore, the Rambam and the Hashalah HaKadosh explain that yes, the Torah tells us, Vayevarech et Yosef, that Yaakov blessed Yosef, definitely he blessed him. By that he blessed his son to be talented and to be clever, that's the blessing that the father can get for his own kids. Let's move on to verse 20. And here we see something extraordinary that we do every Friday night with the kids. Vayivarchem bayom ahu le'emor, becha yevorach Yisrael le'emor, yasimcha Elohim ke'Ephraim ve'ke'Menashe, vayasem et Ephraim lifnei Menashe.
So he blessed him that day, saying, by you shall Israel bless, saying, may Hashem make you like Ephraim and Menashe, and the like Menashe. And he put Ephraim before Menashe.
Yeah. So the question here become that the Mefarshim ask, and this question I'm bringing from Rabbi Tzvi Elimelech Shapira. He born in Galicia 234 years ago, and he asked a valid question. He wrote the book, Igra de Kala, and he asked in his book, why is Bnei Israel should be blessed Dafka with Ephraim and Menashe and not all the other 12 tribes? From the other 12 tribes, we know that they were all righteous. But why Dafka from all the tribes? Yaakov Avinu chose Ephraim and Menashe. So Rabbi Tzvi Elimelech explained that the foundation of our Torah is one very important thing, that the person should not be jealous and not should be arrogant. And when Yaakov Avinu blessed Ephraim and Menashe, we know that he blessed Ephraim that was the little before Menashe. And he put his right hand on Ephraim and the left hand on Menashe. And when Yaakov Avinu said that was no jealousy and no arrogant amongst these two brothers, he realized that that's how should all Bnei Israel should be blessed. And what happened? When Yaakov Avinu blessed the younger child of Yosef, Ephraim, Menashe wasn't so jealous of his brother. And Ephraim, that was the younger, was not arrogant or more proud to say, listen, see, I got blessed before. Yaakov Avinu that saw that, he said, that's the basic and that's the main foundation for our Jewish religion. And if you two not get jealous one of each other and not get arrogant one on each other, that's how I want all Bnei Israel to be blessed, to be like you. Because that's the foundation. And why did he didn't choose none of the other 12 tribes? So say like this. Rabbi Tzvi Elimelech say that the Torah tells us that when Yaakov Avinu make Yosef the garment, for Yosef he make a striped garment. That's the only difference. And what does Hazal say? What does the Torah tell us? Ve'ikan'u bo ehab. So from here we see, say Hazal, and that's what Rabbi Tzvi Elimelech quote. And from here we learn something very important, that the 12 tribes was jealous one of each other. And if there is jealousy amongst them, and there is hatred amongst them, that would bring for damage. So say Rabbi Tzvi Elimelech, when Yaakov Avinu said that the grandchildren, there is no more jealousy, there is no more arrogant, That's the only way that Bnei Israel should be blessed, that you should all live with peace and harmony and love, with no jealousy and no arrogancy. Let's move on to chapter 49. Chapter 49, verse 1. Here we see that Yaakov Avinu called his kids, and he asked them to gather together, and let's read it, and then we'll understand why what's happening. Vayikra Yaakov el banav, vayomer, yasfu, ve'agid alachem et asher yikre etchem be'acharit hayamim.
Then Jacob called for his sons and said, assemble yourselves, and I will tell you what will befall you in the end of days.
Okay, so on the pshat of the Dvarim, Hazal say something very extraordinary. Hazal said that Yaakov Avinu gathered his kids and wanted to tell them what's going to happen to them in the end of days. But the Zohar HaKadosh explained that in that moment that they all got together and he wanted to reveal to them the secret, what's happened to them? Nistalka mimenu ashchina. That means the Ruach HaKodesh, the Holy Spirit, disappeared from him and he couldn't tell him what's going to happen in the end of days. But I saw a commentary of Rabbi Moshe Yehuda Leiv ben Yaakov Misasov. He born in the Ukraine 272 years ago, and he says something extraordinary. He said, you know, why did Yaakov Avinu gathers his 12 sons and he wanted to speak to them? He wanted to reveal to them a secret. And you know what was the secret? He wanted to give them advice. What was the advice? That's going to be a lifesaver for them during all the difficult time until the Mashiach come. He say like this, Yasfu ve'agida. That means gather together and become one unit. That means join together and be united with no faribol. That means that the lifesaver for the Jewish people when they are united. When the Jewish people united and they together with no faribol, that's going to be the lifesaver during all the difficulty. Not only that, a Jew can survive only when they unit. When they become one unit and united with no different ideas, no different feelings, with no mahloket, that's the lifesaver of the Jewish people. So that's what Yaakov Avinu wanted to suggest to his son, and that's the advice that he wanted to give them. That's according to Rabbi Moshe Yehuda Leiv ben Yaakov Misasov. And please God, we should all take that advice, that we should all be united. Let's move on, and with that I would like to conclude. In chapter 50, in verse 16, the Torah tells us something extraordinary. Here the Torah tells us that the brother said to Yosef HaTzadik something that never happened. But let's see if it did happen or not. Vayitzavu el Yosef le'emor, avicha tziva lifnei moto le'emor. Chapter 50, verse 16.
So they instructed that Joseph be told, your father gave orders before his death, saying. Okay.
So here we see that the brother said to Yosef HaTzadik that Yaakov Avinu, his father, instructed them to forgive them for what they done to him, that they sold him as a slave. And the Mefarshim ask, where does it say that Yaakov Avinu actually instructed Yosef to forgive him? So Hazal say he never instructed him. You don't going to see anywhere in the Torah that Yaakov Avinu instructed Yosef to forget his brothers. Rashi HaKadosh say that Yaakov Avinu didn't even worry about it because he knew who's his son Yosef. And he knew that Yosef was a tzaddik, a righteous man, and he will forgive his brother. So why did they change? Mishum darkei shalom. And Hazal tell us in Gemara that the person allowed to change, mishum darkei shalom. If it's come to peace, a person allowed to change the word as long that it's going to cause and bring shalom. Shalom is peace between one each other. I saw that another commentary that brought but Likutei Megidim, in his book he says something, that Yaakov Avinu actually did command his brothers. Yaakov Avinu did command the brothers to tell Yosef to forgive them for the sin that they done, that they sold them. So say Likutei Megidim, if you look at the verse that we just read before in chapter 49, verse 1, what does it say there? Yasfu ve'agidana, ve'agidalachem. That means, gather together and become one unity. Say, Delikutei Megidim, that how people can be united and can be one unit, it's only in one way. Once that one forgive each other, only then you can become a unity. So say the Likutei Megidim, from here we learn that Yaakov Avinu did command it, but he didn't send it, he didn't say it directly. But he said, Yasfu ve'agida lachem, that when you're going to gather together, and when you're going to be one unity together, how can you be unity together when you forgive one each other? And Be'ezrat Hashem, HaKadosh Baruch Hu will make Bnei Israel and all Am Israel, wherever he is, all over, especially in Eretz Israel, that we should all forgive one each other, we should be united, and we'll dive into HaKadosh Baruch Hu, and HaKadosh Baruch Hu will see that we're united, and then send us Mashiach Tzidkenu B'mehra B'yameinu Amen Ken Yehi Ratzon.